Part 2 of Malachi. Chapter 2 of Malachi. Starting at verse 1, I invite you to follow along in the reading of God's Word this morning, the last prophet, the last book of the Old Testament. So if you're not sure where Malachi is, go to Matthew and back up. We'll read through verse 16, starting at verse 1. And now this admonition is for you, O priests. If you do not listen, and if you do not set your heart to honor my name, says the Lord Almighty, I will send a curse upon you, and I will curse your blessings. Yes, I have already cursed them, because you have not set your heart to honor me. Because of you, I will rebuke your descendants. I will spread on your faces the offal from your festival sacrifices, and you will be carried off with it. And you will know that I have sent you this admonition so that my covenant with Levi may continue, says the Lord Almighty. My covenant was with him, a covenant of life and peace, and I gave them to him. This called for reverence, and he revered me and stood in awe of my name. True instruction was in his mouth, and nothing false was found on his lips. He walked with me in peace and uprightness and turned many from sin. For the lips of a priest ought to preserve knowledge, and from his mouth men should seek instruction, because he is the messenger of the Lord Almighty. But you have turned from the way, and by your teaching have caused many to stumble. You have violated the covenant with Levi, says the Lord Almighty. So I have caused you to be despised and humiliated before all the people, because you have not followed my ways, but have shown partiality in matters of the law. Have we not all one Father? Did not one God create us? Why do we profane the covenant of our fathers by breaking faith with one another? Judah has broken faith. A detestable thing has been committed in Israel and in Jerusalem. Judah has desecrated the sanctuary the Lord loves by marrying the daughter of a foreign god. As for the man who does this, whoever he may be, may the Lord cut him off from the tents of Jacob, even though he brings offerings to the Lord Almighty. Another thing you do, you flood the Lord's altar with tears. You weep and wail because he no longer pays attention to your offerings or accepts them with pleasure from your hands. You ask why? It is because the Lord is acting as the witness between you and the wife of your youth, because you have broken faith with her, though she is your partner, the wife of your marriage covenant. Has not the Lord made them one? In flesh and spirit they are his. And why one? Because he was seeking godly offspring. So guard yourself in your spirit, and do not break faith with the wife of your youth. I hate divorce, says the Lord God of Israel, and I hate a man's covering himself with violence, as well as with his garment, says the Lord Almighty. So guard yourself in your spirit and do not break faith. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of God endures forever. Well, Malachi continues here the message that he started in chapter 1, obviously giving a strong admonition to the priests of his day. And again, in case you missed last Sunday's message, this is an admonition to all of us today, who know Christ, who serve the Lord, because we are, 1 Peter 2:9, a royal priesthood. We are priests of the Lord in Jesus Christ. One thing is very clear here, that God has a stricter judgment in store for those who are the spiritual leaders of his people. James 3:1 might be a verse that comes to mind. It says, "Not many of you should presume to be teachers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly." Now, that doesn't mean you shouldn't volunteer to teach. Don't take it that way. It means the standards of accountability are higher for those who have the potential, by their example, by their teaching, by their words, to lead other people, especially children, astray. Tragically, this word of warning seems to be greatly ignored and violated in many churches today, because we have pastors, elders, teachers, and churches today who are absolute heretics and apostates, and yet their congregations, their denominations do absolutely nothing to hold them accountable to the word of God. Pastors and other leaders in the church who always tell you what you want to hear and always strive to make you feel good when you leave church and never confront the sin in your life are not doing you any favors. May I dare to say that they don't even love you. If you are driving on a road to self-destruction, if you are headed towards a spiritual cliff, let's call it, the most loving thing that anyone can do is to warn you to get off the road and head in the opposite direction. Let's look at verse 2. God is outraged at the hypocrisy of these Jewish priests. He declares that he will even curse their blessings. Now, scholars are a little bit debated about what that means. Most of them feel that it could mean one of two things: either that God was going to turn all of their material, physical blessings into material, physical curses. So a prospering business becomes a failing business, good health becomes poor health, etc. That, or God was going to cause the words of blessing that the priests pronounce, the benedictions, if you will, over the people to actually become, to have the opposite effect, to become curses over the people. God says in the next verse, I will rebuke your descendants. You might have a footnote in your Bible says, I will cut off your descendants. I will cut off your children, your lineage. And I will spread on your faces the offal from your festival sacrifices, and you will be carried off with it. Now, if you're not sure what offal is, O-F-F-A-L, I will tell you that it's just awful. It is dung, D-U-N-G. In fact, the King James translates it very literally, I will spread dung on your faces. Now, there's a pretty picture. God's talking about the manure that came into the temple courts with all of the various animals that the people were bringing for their sacrifices. And some lucky sap apparently had the distinguished job of going around and cleaning up the, I'll be discreet here, the droppings on the temple floor, putting them into a cart and wheeling them out the city gates to a huge dung heap outside the city. God says, your ministry, O priests, is so detestable to me that I will have them throw you on the cart and wheel you out of the city. God had chosen the tribe of Levi, of the 12 tribes of Israel, the Levites, to minister to the rest of the nation. They were to run the temple, run the tabernacle, set apart for God by carrying out the ministry, the whole sacrificial system. And God says in verse 5 that my covenant with him, with Levi, was a covenant of life and of peace. Do you know that even from the beginning of the sacrificial system, God was not really interested in having the blood and the burned flesh of animals? No, he was interested in a relationship with us. He wanted to bestow life and peace on his people. And folks, that is every bit as true today as it was 4,000 years ago. The word life here doesn't just mean being alive, you know, breathing and kicking, as we say. It means abundant life, as Jesus said, long life, full life, satisfying life. It means being really fully alive and enjoying life as God meant it to be enjoyed. And the word peace here is the Hebrew word shalom, which, as many of you know, means so much more than just peace as the absence of conflict. It means wholeness, and it means prosperity. It means good health. It means salvation. And the word shalom actually came to be used as a greeting and as a farewell among the Jewish people. You know, when they were saying good morning to each other or you know, parting from a meeting, they'd say, shalom. We would say, God bless you. God touch everything in your life with blessing. Levi received that blessing of life and peace, verse 5 says. And God tells us why. He tells us why Levi got those blessings. Four things are mentioned here. Take a look. He revered me and stood in awe of my name. True instruction was in his mouth, and nothing false was found on his lips. He walked with me in peace and uprightness, and he turned many from sin. Friends, we have these same callings of God upon our lives. We are the priests of God in this world, and those behaviors should characterize our lives. Verse 7 goes on to say that the lips of a priest, certainly the lips of a preacher, the lips of a Sunday school or a family night teacher, the lips of a Christian ought to preserve knowledge. It says people should be able to seek true and right instruction from our mouths. And let me just ask you this morning, do you think people can do that with you? I mean, are you a source of reliable, godly counsel for the people in your family or your workplace or your friends? As a parent or as a grandparent, as a husband or a wife, as the high priest of your home, do you keep and do you speak the true knowledge of God? And do people seek that from you because they know that you possess it? If not, why not? God says here that he, the priest, is the messenger of the Almighty. And remember I told you last week that Malachi, the name, literally means my messenger. But today we are God's messenger. You're God's messenger to your home, to your school, to your workplace, to your neighborhood, to the city of Muskegon and beyond, to the world. God's messenger. God has called us, he's chosen us, he's redeemed us for that purpose. But verse 8 says, goes on, you have turned from the way. You, by your teaching, you've caused people to stumble. And this goes on around us all the time, doesn't it? And, you know, sometimes it just blows my mind. I was reading an article in a religious newsletter that comes to me via email a while back about an Episcopal bishop. And I think this was out east somewhere. I want to say Maryland or New Jersey, I can't remember, who declared that the Ten Commandments are immoral. And was just ripping up and down the Word of God, saying that it's okay to live in whatever lifestyle you choose. Jesus was a transvestite. And just going on and on with blasphemy of every imaginable kind. And I read this stuff and I think, Lord, you are surely more merciful than I, because if I had the thunderbolts in my hand, there would be one fried bishop in America. Oh, it just makes me angry. And everybody who wants to live in their sin, everybody who wants to just please themselves and live narcissistically and indulge the flesh will draw near to a person like that, to a wacko like that, when what they really need, and I dare say what they really want, in the emptiness and the ache of their souls, is Jesus Christ. That's what they need. People, friends, need the truth of the gospel. But because so many Christians, and I'll include my own vocation, so many pastors don't speak the real truth of the gospel, people turn from the way. They turn away from the Bible, they turn away from the church, and they turn away from God himself. Because no one has the courage to give them true instruction. Here's what's wrong with your life. Here's what you must do. Let's look at the second section of chapter 2 here, verse 10 and following. The attitude in the nation of Israel at this time is that people were profaning the covenant that God had made with them. And just by the way, anytime you see the word covenant in Scripture, you can substitute for that the word relationship. It's a relationship of promise. And the Jews were profaning theirs with God. Malachi is going to give some examples of how this works in terms of that mindset and that behavior, how it had kind of crept into their homes and families. But just like today, marriages and families then were the essential building blocks of their whole society. And so the violation of their covenant with God was leading to the destruction of the whole nation. Now, does this sound to you at all like what is happening in America today? It sure does to me. Sounds like very much the same thing. Let's see what Malachi says was going on back then. In verse 10, God says the people are breaking faith with one another, and he'll demonstrate that in a moment. But then in verse 11, he says that they've broken faith with God himself. Now, the NIV renders that they've desecrated the sanctuary, but the King James, I think, renders it a little bit more accurately to the Hebrew, says Judah has profaned the holiness of the Lord. They have profaned the holiness of the Lord himself. And I think this is something that so many people fail to understand. When we stand before God and we make a covenant with another person or with a group of persons, such as marriage or baptism or profession of faith in the church or what have you, but then they fail to keep their promises to that person or those groups of persons, they are actually breaking covenant with God, because God was and is part of the covenant. It was as much a covenant with God as it was with the other party. And God uses the illustration of marriage here to drive his point home, because marriage is like a triangle, and that's what you see on the screen. It's not merely about two people coming together. It is a sacred spiritual union of which God is the head. By the way, would God be the head of a same-sex union? Of course not. Of course not. It says in verse 14 that God is the witness between you and the wife of your youth, implied the husband of your youth. It works both ways. What that means is that God hears and God sees everything that goes on between the two of you. Let that sink in a moment. It takes three people to make marriage work: the husband, the wife, and God. And the moment that you separate God out of the triangle, the relationship will begin to break down. And I always tell couples in premarital counseling, if you want to get closer to each other, just both of you try to get closer to God, because your union is right up there at the top. Down here, there's distance. You try to do this without God, it won't work. You move this way towards God, and what does he do? He unites you. That was free. What was happening in Israel is that the men were marrying pagan women of other nations who worshipped other gods. Strictly forbidden in the law of Moses, Exodus 34, Deuteronomy 7, 1 Kings 11, just three that I could find that say that. And what God is doing here is that he's linking the institution of marriage to his own holiness. He's saying, whenever you profane your spouse and you disregard the covenant that you made before me, you are really profaning me, because I am in that relationship. And that relationship is holy in my sight. And it needs to be in your sight too. Now, the word holy literally means set apart. God says, I have set you apart from all the other people of the world. I've set you apart for one another. I've set you apart for my glory. And the way in which I tell you to do this has to be followed. If you don't follow my instruction, my guidance, it's not going to work. If you separate from one another, if you allow separateness among you, between you, you destroy my whole purpose in bringing you together in the first place. Now, these Jewish men weren't just single men who were marrying those who were the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Termites. That wasn't one of them. Many of them were already married to Jewish women. And what they were doing is that they were divorcing their Jewish wives in order to run after these young, beautiful pagan women. They were looking for a younger model. They wanted to trade in for a newer model. It's like they were all in some kind of midlife crisis or something. I think it was Agatha Christie who once encouraged women that if they're going to marry, make sure they marry an archaeologist or a historian. Because the older you get, the more interested in you they will become. Oh, boy. I don't know why I put that in here, but anyway. In doing this, these Jewish men got involved in idolatry. Obviously, they wanted to please their wives. We're all about that, aren't we, guys? But the children that were raised in those homes were not children of the covenant. They were idol-worshipping children. And it was destroying the nation. Now, God says in verse 12 that the man who does this will be cut off from the tents of Jacob, which means that he will be removed from the covenant with Israel, i.e., he will lose his relationship to God. Is that saying that he'll lose his salvation? God knows. And folks, this is why Paul says in his letters to the Corinthians that believers should only marry believers. And I know we've got some single folks here today, and you need to hear this. Listen to Paul's words in 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Do not be yoked together with unbelievers. What do righteousness and wickedness have in common? All of these are rhetorical questions here. What fellowship can light have with darkness? What does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? What agreement is there between the temple of God and the temple of idols? We are the temple of the living God. For a Christian man or woman to marry someone who is not committed to Christ opens them to the possibility of being influenced to depart from Christ, to wander off the way. I've seen it happen time after time after time, and many of you have too. Maybe it's happened to some of your own children. Now, the principle in that passage doesn't mean only marriage. It obviously applies to other relationships in life too, but marriage is certainly the most sacred of all human relationships, and the command of God must be followed there above all others. Let me just give you one tangent as an aside that really concerns me. Your marriage is more important than your relationship to your children. And some of us make a grave error here. By making our relationship to our kids more important than our relationship to our spouse. You bend over backwards, you empty your wallet for your kids, to please your kids, to provide for your kids, to do anything to make sure they know that they are cared for, and you live in disrespect and dishonor of your spouse. And Satan knows very well what that will produce. Don't do it, beloved. And if you are doing it, change your ways. That is not God's pattern for the home. One of the last things God has to say to the nation of Israel as the whole Old Testament comes to a close is to warn them that they are losing their distinctiveness as his people on earth because they're messing around with foreigners. They're dabbling with the world. They're getting enmeshed in the culture. And they're losing their identity, which was primarily an identity of worshiping the one true living God. That is what set Israel apart from all the other nations of the world. They worshiped the one true living God, the creator of all that is. And they were losing it. And the verses following, the verses that I just read in 2 Corinthians 6, Paul quotes from the Old Testament, 2 Samuel, where God is establishing his covenant with King David. And he says, take a look at this, "Therefore come out from them and be separate, says the Lord. Touch no unclean thing, and I will receive you. I will be a father to you, and you will be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty." I think God really wants to remind us today that there is a difference between clean and unclean, between holy and common, between us and the world. And in many ways, the church has been losing that distinctiveness in our day. Malachi says here that even if you come to the altar with a big offering, even if you flood the altar with tears because you fear being cut off from God, God won't pay any attention to you. Now that sounds harsh, but why? It's because they were still walking in blatant disobedience. He says, "You don't revere my name like Levi did." And I think this whole concept of reverence is misunderstood today. I hear people talk about reverence today, and they give examples like kids running inside the sanctuary, or people not coming to worship with nice clothes on, or people being a little bit too casual when they celebrate the Lord's Supper, being too happy, if there is such a thing, coming to the Lord's table, those kind of things. Now, it could certainly include those kinds of things, but listen, reverence for God in the Bible means respecting God's power and authority, which leads to, listen, obedience to God's commands and forsaking every sin in your life. That's what reverence means. And apparently the men of Malachi's day would come to church and they would cry, "Oh God, I've been so bad. I'm such a jerk. My family is such a mess. Wah." But then they would go home and they would cheat on their wives and enter into illicit relationships with pagan women and just return to living the way they had been living all week long, indulging the flesh. Do you know I get people like that coming to me here? They say, "Oh, Pastor, I've backslidden. I've compromised. I feel just horrible. What should I do?" And I tell them, God can forgive you, but he wants you to repent. And he wants you to repent for good. He wants you to leave that thing and to stay away from it. But so many of them go back to the same old thing because they're in bondage to it. And they don't know how to rely and draw on the strength of the Holy Spirit and of Christ that is available to them. And it's just the cycle repeats itself. God says, "Man, I am sick and tired of this. This is so detestable to me." Which leads me to say that if you are going to get in with Christ, then get in. But if you're going to get out, if you want to get out, I should say, then just get out. Don't be a hypocrite. If you have not yet had enough of the pleasures of the world, you are free to go out there and live like a rebel. But do not make a mockery of God and play games with the Almighty. And do not expect him to bless you and make your life wonderful and comfortable and listen to your prayers every time you're in a little bit of trouble. Don't do it. Now we come finally to this last verse, this verse 16, where God says, "I hate divorce." If you are a divorced person here this morning, and I know that we have many of them here, please hear this carefully. God does not say, "I hate the divorced person." He says, "I hate the divorce. I hate what it does to people. I hate what it does to their children." Now, do you know we should all be glad for this statement? Because the Lord also says in his word, "You are the bride of Christ." Understand? I mean, let's not complain about the fact that God hates divorce when he has married himself to you. We should be happy about this. because he will never leave us, never forsake us, no matter how many times we mess up. And let's remember, too, let's not rank divorce up here and everything else down here. God hates all sin. He hates drunkenness. He hates lying. He hates unjust violence. God hates lots of things, but he doesn't hate people. And he doesn't hate you. He hates what all of those things produce in us and what they do to us. And divorce is no exception. I mean, he just mentions that one here because of what the Jewish men were doing in his day. But we look at all the grief and the misery and the problems that divorce creates, and all of us probably hate divorce, right? So if you're divorced here today and we come to this text, I mean, don't stick your fingers in your ears and just wait for me to move on in the passage. Let's deal honestly with any infidelity in our spirits. Let's deal honestly with that. Because we need to look at what God says right before I hate divorce and right after I hate divorce. He says, guard yourself in your spirit and do not break faith. And you say, well, how do you do that? And I submit to you that there's only one way. You need to put on Christ. And if you say you know Christ and that you live for Christ every single day, you still need to put on Christ. Because you can't do this in your own strength. I know, I've been there and done that. It doesn't work. We are like dogs that return to our vomit. We are like the Israelites longing for the flesh pots of Egypt. We will go back to our sin unless we stand in the power of Christ. He's the only answer, friends. So let's pray for that. Let's bow our heads, please. Lord, this has not been an easy word, but I sense in my heart, Lord, that it wasn't is a necessary word. It challenges some of us at a very deep level of our being, of our rationality, of our affection. But God, you are calling us to a higher standard, to holiness. You say, be ye holy even as I am holy. And Lord, we hear that, we see that, and we say it's impossible. But then we read that your word says, nothing is impossible for me. And Lord, when we think about the power of your Holy Spirit and what you are able to do and what you have shown that you can do in a human being who is frail and weak and sinful and rebellious and fickle and unfaithful, that Lord, you can turn us into the men and women and children that we need to be and ought to be and you call us to be by the power of that Spirit. And Lord, if there's any person here who, this morning, who doesn't know what it means to put on Christ for the first time, to look to Christ and trust Christ to bring them out of their sin and to break the power of that sin in their life and to trust in him alone for salvation, to receive the gift of eternal life, to know that every sin, past, present, and future, is and will be forgiven. And Lord, I pray that by the Spirit of God, you would just draw them to yourself and you would help them to cry out to you, come into my heart, Lord Jesus. I repent and I want to repent for good. I want to leave this life of sin and I want to live as your holy child, bringing glory to you all of my days. Come into my heart and change me, make me a new creation. For I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.